and see what all the top of it.
Not breaking anything. And you're watching
and we had just a little bit of a breeze over the ground, which makes life very pleasant for the anybody understand. It'd be nice to have a little forward, a little breeze, maybe if they land in the grass and stop them from landing. But that last jumper's just kind of hanging there. He says, I don't care what they said today, I'm not coming down. All right, you can see the assault is underway right now as the troops that landed first are attacking the opposing forces and securing the airport. And if you listen, you may even hear the gunfire. That C-17 you see making a big wide turn out there is 174 feet long and a 170 foot wingspan. And those big winglets on the wing tips aid the stability of the aircraft. It's powered by four fully reversible Pratt Whitney F-117 PW-100 engines. The commercial version is currently used on the Boeing 757. Each engine is rated at 40,900 pounds of thrust. The reversers direct the flow of air upward and forward to avoid ingestion of dust and debris. You can hear the gunfire out there as the first deck is coming in to secure the area so we can get the balance of the Red Horse team up here with their equipment, and you have yet to see that equipment. That C-17 is operated by Crew 3, pilot, co-pilot, and loadmaster. Cargo is loaded and loaded onto the C-17 through large half doors that accommodate military vehicles and Valentine's cargo. The C-17 can carry virtually all the Army's air transportable outside combat equipment. The C-17 is also able to airdrop paratroopers and cargo. Maximum payload capacity of the C-17, 170,900 pounds. And its maximum gross takeoff weight is 585,000 pounds. With a payload of 130,000 pounds and initial cruise altitude of 28,000 feet, the C-17 has an operational range of 5,200 nautical miles. Its cruise speed of 450 knots, that is a little over 500 miles an hour. The design of this plane lets it operate on small, austere airfields. The C-17 can take off and land on one way as short as 3,000 feet, and as narrow as 90 feet wide. Even on such narrow runways, the C-17 can turn around by using its backing capability while performing a three-point star turn. Maximum use has been made of off-the-shelf and commercial equipment, including Air Force standardized avionics. We're going to be watching the C-17 make a maximum effort landing out here. This is a tactical approach to landing, and just keep your eye on it on the right side. We're going to enjoy this. The C-17 made its maiden flight on September 15th of 91. The aircraft is operated by the Air Mobility Command with the initial operations at Charleston Air Force Base, South Carolina, with the 437th Airlift Wing and the 315th Airlift Wing. That's the Air Force Reserve. The C-17 program is managed by the Aeronautical Systems Center, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio. Okay, apparently the runway is not clear yet, so this is another low pass. He's staying right in the area, and he's going to continue to make passes until the runway is usable. So there's another pass, and this again is from Charleston Air Force Base, South Carolina. And joint conventional special operations have become the norm. One of the newest additions to the inventory is the Air Force Airborne Red Horse Team. The airborne concept that reflects 21st century realities applies to the proven Air Force capabilities found in rapid engineered deployable heavy operational repair squadron engineer. That's Red Horse units. That's the acronym. To understand where the Airborne Red Horse Team capabilities developed itself, they have a working knowledge of it. They're performing required engineering support for bend-down of weapon systems, particularly in bear-based environments during initial and sustained phases of contingency operations. In addition to three active Red Horse component Red Horse squadrons in CONUS in continental United States, there is also Red Horse squadrons in both Air Force Reserve and National Guard components, as well as additional active component Red Horse units command control company, the three active active duty squad. In terms of need to have Air Force engineers on the ground in Kosovo to rehabilitate airfields that the U.S. has previously denied to the enemy. The idea grew after Drucker became commander of Air Combat Command and then chief of staff, with the airborne Red Horse team concept subsequently validated during operations conducted in Florida in November of 2002. Just over the size of a standard, twice the size of a standard Red Horse R1 Echelon, the new airborne Red Horse team consists of 35 individuals, 21 airmen, drawn from the Red Horse squadron, augmented by 6 explosive forces, supposedly EOD members, 6 firefighters, and 2 troops that specialize in nuclear, biological, and chemical defense. Notice I did say nuclear. Anybody who says nuclear is not permitted on a United States military reservation. Moreover, the team 21 traditional Red Horse members represent a broad cross-section of capabilities. Okay, this is going to be the last pass, and then he'll be coming around the land. He'll dogbone out to the right side, turn around and land on the opposite direction. But you see this, that's a big airplane, considering it's being flown by 2 people up front and the loadmaster. They're crew chiefs. In addition to that, if you didn't realize, you figure big transports, you know, that's just there with the yoke. But no, this thing's got a stick. You fly it, and as your pilot commands, you fly it with your stick in the left hand. And I kind of do that, and it's really tough, and I just couldn't quite get the stick there and the throttle here. Red Horse are clearly evident in the airborne Red Horse team mission set, which Brigadier General Burns, Air Combat Command civil engineer, described as light, lean, and lethal. Airborne Red Horse is a smaller set that can be picked up and moved quickly. A standard Red Horse squadron of 404 people has a lot of equipment that comes with it. It can take a long time for sea lift to move that type of capability, and the airplanes that we need to move it in theater are in high demand. The Airborne Red Horse concept is really a light engineer capability to do initial assessment and initiate repair operations. I want you to watch out to the right as the C-17 is this time going to make a maximum effort landing, and I know when he was flying this yesterday, he certainly did stop it in under 3,000 feet. And to stop this airplane that quickly is going some. This is a big bird. And you don't know how big until you stand next to it. And he immediately goes to the data reversion. I can see those reverse numbers. So with looking at this, he still had the ailerons control on the ground. The spoilers come up to kill off any residual lift and keep those wheels firmly on the ground for maximum braking effort. And he did indeed stop that thing at under 3,000 feet. And he's going to pull the airplane, or the airplane be pulled in here in front of us, and then show you its maneuverability. They're going to position the airplane in order to be able to offload the equipment and not have to take the equipment any great distance. We would like to request that our national anthem singer come to the stage as soon as possible. We'd like the performer of the national anthem to please come to our stage. It should be Airman First Diana Stewart. But Airman First Stewart, if you're in earshot, I hope you get yourself up to the stage sometime quickly. You're going to see them reverse the engines. Actually, you'll see them reverse the engines. moved back, and there they are. And the crew chief standing there on the back ramp is actually being sort of camouflaged over there on the left side, but that's where they're gonna fit. And as the ramp comes all the way down, we're gonna want to move the equipment out. They've got to get the equipment off here, grab the sample, and move out to the work site. In this case, they'll demonstrate the crater is there right out there on the taxi ramp. First thing it comes out, the little ATV, so whoever's in charge. You've got around both easily, and both looks to me like the water people have come off as well. So they're going to be through in water. Well, got the water pollution. They're not fooling around. Next thing off is the front loader, the bucket loader, with the back load on it, depending upon how much digging they have to do. Then I don't even know what they call that thing. It's a utility, like a dump body on treads. And that's where they're going to pick up the crud, put it away, and then their little, I think they use those things to clear the snow off of paths, and the massive features that those digging ship loaders, the two of them are going to work together to clean up the crater damage over there. This whole time, the professionals of ASOC 21st Special Tactics Squadron have quietly performing air duty, controlling the airborne operations and drop zones without their assistance. The airborne ops was not taking place. As a matter of fact, you know, they probably have the airplanes that are in the air, they're waiting on the land, and they've got to fix the damage report. That can happen. Give away to the 437 Maryland plane quietly. Quickly as someone can get to here. funds.